Hi and welcome. If you only ever want to show part of a larger element in your UI, you need to work with a mask. And luckily, working with masks is rather easy, and we'll have a look at four different ones in this tutorial. A super performant and simple rectangular mask, a mask in the shape of any given sprite, soft masks, and lastly, inverted masks. We'll create our own shader in Shadergraph for the last two, but even if you have never worked with Shadergraph before, you'll manage to follow along just fine. Rect masks are the least resource-hungry mask you can create for your UI. Let's see how we can mask this sprite into a rectangular box. This way, it would fit very well into a vertical layout group, for example. Create a new image object on your canvas and add the RectMask2D component to it. Drop in the image you want to mask, and that's already it. You can now move and size the image as you want, and it will have a perfectly rectangular cutout visible. You can recolor the rect mask image if you want to, or change it for a different image. But this component actually does not require an image at all. Instead of reading an attached image and its alpha channel, it works with the width and height values you can find inside the rect transform at the top. This is what makes it lightweight when it comes to performance. Rect masks also come with padding and even offer softness around the edges, which helps a lot if you need a bit more control over how it should fit and blend into your UI. The rect mask is what's being used for scrollable text boxes, for example, but can be used in lots of other areas as well. I can drop it into my vertical layout here and have it expand automatically to the size allowed for it, and it works very well. If you struggle with layout groups, maybe watch my tutorial on them after this one. I am sure you won't curse them as much after watching this. You work with a mask component if you want more elaborate shapes. Create a new image child object on your canvas and give it the image with the shape you want to work with. Again, you can color it however you want to, of course. Drag the image you want to mask into it. This time attach a mask component, and you can already see parts being cut off based on the sprite's alpha channel. That typically works alright for most use cases, but however, if you zoom in, you can see small artifacts and random pixels where they are not supposed to pop up. This is because the mask component doesn't really understand gray values in masks, and instead has a fixed cutoff point for when it sees a value as transparent or not. If this is fine for you, and really it always depends on the use case and size of the sprites you are working with, you can also click on the toggle button to hide the mask image in case your design requires it. Just be aware that masks don't care for 9-sliced images and will always act as if you are using simple images instead. If you have large elements that need to be masked to a specific size, it might be the best idea to export that as a new mask image with those specific sizes directly from your art application of choice. And if you ever need to exclude a graphic or a text from any given mask in its parents, you can find checkboxes to do so here on the image component and here for any Text Mesh Pro component. Let's see how we can create soft masks with just a super simple shader graph material. That is going to look like this. Thanks to Unity 6 providing the ability to create UI shaders, this is done with just a few clicks. Create a new shader graph by right-clicking in your project window, Create, Shader Graph, URP, Canvas Shader Graph. Double-click it to open it. We need two elements for our mask to work. The main texture, called Main Text, which you create by clicking on the plus button and picking Texture from the lineup. Please don't call it anything else. We want this to automatically pick the image component's source image. In the Graph Inspector, untick the Visible in Inspector checkbox and set a default image so that we can see what is happening inside our shader graph network. Create a second texture and call it Mask. This should stay visible in the inspector. Again, set up a default mask you would like to work with. Start by dragging the main text into the empty area to the left of this block. This will handle how the end result will be rendered, so everything we have to do comes before that. Graphs are typically read from left to right or top to bottom. This is pretty much a left to right kind of graph. We need to sample the texture before we can work with it. To do so, tap your spacebar and enter Sample. Then pick Sample Texture 2D from the list. Connect the texture by clicking on the red dot and dragging a line from there to the texture slot. This is how you connect so-called nodes with one another. Drag the RGBA dot to the base color of the fragment node. This way you tell the shader that you want the visuals to look like the image you set up inside the main text. In your shader graph, you might see a different one than the one you are using in any given image component, but that is alright. It will automatically grab the source image later. Repeat these steps with the mask texture. Drag it into the empty area. Create a sampler node. Link up the texture and texture field. But instead of attaching it to the base color inside the fragment, use the alpha block of it. Save the result. We are not quite done, but we can see the first result at this stage. Right-click on the shader graph file and create a new material from it. Drag the material onto any image's material slot you want to apply this effect to. Expand your material view and choose a mask to work with. If it has gray values and isn't just black and white, those values will be used to calculate transparency, giving you a soft mask. This material already works well for every image you want to apply a soft mask to that doesn't have any kind of transparency itself. So let's make sure the shader doesn't just use the mask texture, but also takes any inherent transparency of the main texture into account. Back in the Shader Graph editor, tap spacebar and search for Multiply. Drag the alpha of both sampler nodes into it. You can see inside the preview area that both alphas are being combined this way. We are going to use the result as the main alpha fragment source. Save the result. You should already see the difference in your scene and game view. And if you enjoyed the tutorial so far, please give it a like and consider subscribing. All that's left is inverting the mask now. We won't have to create any new shader for this, luckily. Tap space and search for 1-. Drag your alpha output into this input field. Create a new bool value and call it inverted. Tap space and enter branch. Drag the bool value to the left of it and connect it to the predicate. For true, connect the 1- output. For false, connect the output of the multiply node. The result will then be fed to the fragment's alpha. Save the result and switch back to the scene view. In your material's properties, you can now find a check mark for inverting the mask. You can access the mask image and checkbox by code 2. This code, for example, switches out the mask texture when the player hovers over the image, while this code toggles the inversion on or off based on hover status. You can't set a bool, so instead you'll have to utilize an int you set to 0 or 1 respectively. And lastly, if you're using the same material across elements, but only want to change parts of it in one place while keeping the others as they are, you will have to create a copy of the assigned material through code. This is what it would look like in this case. You create a new material based on the attached material. This will create a new instance, and every change you apply will only apply to this one location. I hope you enjoyed the tutorial. Leave a comment about which mask you use the most and if that changed with the new material. Have a great week!